What is inside a black hole? And if you fall into a black hole, will you be stuck in its singularity forever as time stops? Or will you emerge through the singularity into another universe or a white hole? In 1915, when Einstein published his theory of relativity, many scientists identified various problems within it. Since then, several scientists have solved these problems and made their own discoveries. Many equations and ideas have emerged suggesting that a black hole is not the end of the universe, but rather a pathway to white holes and the multiverse. Beyond the darkness of black holes, there could be a world where the laws of physics and quantum mechanics are entirely different from our own. Life in such worlds might also be fundamentally different from ours. But how can we reach these worlds, and how do black holes connect our universe to other universes and white holes? So, hello guys, you are watching Brain Bargain, and let's embark on another exciting journey into the wonders of this incredible universe. A war had broken out between the armies of Germany and Russia, which was part of one of the biggest events in the world, World War I. In this war, German physicist Karl Schwarzschild was fighting against Russia for his country. His job was to calculate the correct trajectories for the German army's weapons and rocket launches so they could destroy as many of Russia's important bases and tanks as possible. But in the midst of this war, another world-changing event occurred. In 1915, Einstein published his general theory of relativity. This was Einstein's revolutionary theory that transformed the entire scientific world and finally answered a debate that had been going on for 200 years about how gravity interacts between celestial bodies in the universe. Einstein's relativity equations simplify our understanding of how gravity works, explaining that gravity is simply the distorted curvature developed by massive objects in the space-time of the universe. Other less massive objects are attracted to this curvature. This space-time curvature even bends light, and due to the combination of the time dimension in the space-time fabric, time runs slower around massive objects. However, there were some problems with Einstein's general theory of relativity, some serious problems. For instance, the field equations of general theory of relativity, which are used to calculate the gravitational field generated in the space-time curvature around a mass, were completely failing and giving strange, unpredictable answers. This is where Karl Schwarzschild comes into the picture. During the war in Germany in 1915, when he read Einstein's papers on general theory of relativity, he noticed this incomplete field equation and thought he could solve it. So, during the war, he began working on these equations with his calculations and knowledge of physics. And soon after, he arrived at a solution. Karl Schwarzschild imagined a static universe to solve Einstein's field equations, where a point mass without electric charge and without excess rotation sat at the center, curving the space-time around it. Beyond a certain distance, space-time remained flat. In such a flat space-time, gravity would have no effect on you. However, as you entered the region where space-time was curved by this point mass, your spacecraft would slowly start getting pulled towards the center of this mass. The extent of this pull could be easily determined using the modified version of the field equation provided by Schwarzschild. When Schwarzschild sent the solution to Einstein, Einstein replied that he hadn't thought anyone could formulate such an exact and simple solution to the problem. However, Einstein did not realize that the equation he considered a solution would, in fact, lead to a singularity by breaking the very laws of physics. In 1916, Schwarzschild's equation was published as a solution to the general theory of relativity under the name Schwarzschild metric. However, some scientists identified a major problem in the Schwarzschild metric. When the small r, which is the closest radius to this point of mass, is set to zero in this equation, it results in infinity. This means that the equation has completely broken down because its results, breaking the laws of mathematics and physics, give unrealistic outcomes. This error is termed singularity in scientific terms. And it's not just one singularity. When we set the small r to be equal to the Schwarzschild radius in this equation, the equation shows another infinity. By 1920, this led to two interpretations. Either the equation completely failed to explain the gravitational field, or there existed a mass in the universe where the gravitational field was so intense that nothing could escape from it. However, in the early 20th century, even Einstein himself did not imagine that such an object could actually exist in the universe, so he initially dismissed the concept of singularities. Additionally, many other prominent scientists of that time argued against it, saying it was infeasible because no massive star could collapse to such an extent to form a singularity. But the question arises, why did Einstein and other scientists not want to believe in the existence of singularities? The reason is, even then, most scientists knew that massive objects in the universe, like stars, had a limit to how much they could collapse into a smaller object. For example, when a star is in its young age, the inward force of gravity is balanced by the fusion reactions occurring in its core. However, upon a star's death, gravity's inward force becomes dominant, causing the star to compress into a point of volume with its existing mass. Nuclear forces, which keep electrons, protons, and neutrons at a distance due to their opposite charges, work to prevent the star from fully collapsing. Despite this, the distances between the atomic particles in the star become very small, causing the star's size to shrink to a fraction of its original size, albeit with the same mass, resulting in the formation of highly dense and gravitationally intense objects. This prediction led to the concept of white dwarfs, such as Sirius B, a well-known white dwarf. The story of whether a star can collapse beyond a white dwarf leads us to Indian physicist Subramanian Chandrasekhar, who reached England in the 1930s. During his studies, he researched the limits of stellar collapse and discovered that beyond a certain mass, gravity could overcome even the nuclear forces of a star, causing it to collapse beyond a white dwarf. This maximum mass limit was called the Chandrasekhar limit. According to this limit, if the mass of a star exceeds the Chandrasekhar limit, then when fusion in the core of the star ceases, the inward gravitational force on the star increases so much that the atomic particles of the star's atoms, like electrons and protons, overcome each other's charged forces and fuse together. This fusion forms particles like neutrons, which are about 2,000 times heavier than electrons. This process is so difficult that it's almost impossible. This was the prediction for neutron stars, like many we see in the universe today, for example, RSJ 1856. However, no scientist had yet proven whether a star could collapse even further to the extent that it breaks all the laws of physics and forms a singularity, that is, a black hole. In 1930, the world was on the brink of another war, World War II. At this time, many great physicists were also exploring the quantum world. One of them was J. Robert Oppenheimer, who later played a key role in the development of the nuclear bomb. But before that, on September 1, 1939, Oppenheimer and physicist Hartland Snyder published a paper on black hole singularities. They argued that neutron stars also have a maximum mass limit. Beyond this limit, even the repulsive forces between neutrons cannot prevent the star from collapsing completely, ultimately forming a singularity. In this singularity, the flow of spacetime becomes faster than the speed of light, and all physical laws break down. Neither time nor space operates as usual. Since Einstein did not believe in the concept of singularities, Oppenheimer's paper on singularities was a direct challenge to him. When Einstein read Oppenheimer's paper and examined the calculations closely, he argued that if time stops at a singularity, nothing can enter it. This implied that either our understanding was incorrect or black holes could not exist. Oppenheimer addressed this criticism by explaining that before reaching a black hole singularity, an object must cross the event horizon predicted by Schwarzschild's equation. Beyond the horizon, the flow of spacetime inside the singularity becomes faster than light, which means that photons traveling at light speed can never escape to reach observers outside the black hole. To an outside observer, time appears to be frozen at the event horizon, while an observer crossing the horizon would not notice time stopping and would continue to be pulled towards the singularity. I should clarify that Oppenheimer was discussing time, not gravity. We already know that a black hole's gravity is so intense that it can break down any object at an atomic level before it reaches the event horizon. If we visualize Schwarzschild's and Oppenheimer's representation of a black hole with these additions, we get an image of a black hole. As we know, every object in the universe travels through space-time dimensions, so if we draw a line representing light traveling at the fastest speed from a 45-degree perspective in space-time, we find two different regions in space-time. The first is a cone-shaped future where we are all traveling together, and the second is the past light cone through which we have all traveled. Our future and past, and that of every life in this universe, are within these two light cones and will always remain there unless we break the speed of light or cross a black hole's horizon. But before doing this, let's take a look at a 2D map of the universe and the black hole. This is our universe, where the future and infinite future are upwards, while the past and infinite past are downwards. To the far right is infinite distance, and on the left, you will see the horizon and the black hole. As we can see in this diagram, as soon as we use an advanced rocket to cross the horizon of a black hole from the universe and enter inside, we have only one path, which leads to the singularity, the end of time. But in 1963, physicist Penrose drew coordinates opposite to the singularity, giving us a new diagram known as the Penrose diagram. This diagram reveals another region opposite the black hole with properties opposite to it, known as a white hole. Many scientists believe that black holes are connected to white holes, and this idea is taken into consideration here. In short, according to the Penrose diagram, if you fall into a static black hole, also known as a Schwarzschild black hole, the Penrose diagram suggests you will emerge from a white hole. However, once you reach a white hole, things change because the white hole ejects you somewhere in the universe. One option is your own universe, but no one knows in which part or timeline of the universe you will end up after exiting the white hole. Additionally, there is a second option. You might enter a new, parallel universe, which is the opposite of our universe, where gravity repels instead of attracting. This parallel universe appears opposite to our real universe in the Penrose diagram. Both universes, connected by black holes and white holes, meet at a point called the Einstein-Rosen bridge. In simpler words, a wormhole connecting the two universes and offering the shortest route for travel between them. But can you travel to this parallel universe using this route? Many researchers have found that the time and size of such Einstein-Rosen bridges are highly unpredictable. To use it as a bridge, it would need to be enlarged, requiring antimatter. Even then, how long the bridge would remain open and whether any human could survive traveling through it remains uncertain. So far, we have been discussing static black holes with Schwarzschild's mathematical solutions, meaning black holes without electric charge or rotational axis. However, as we can see in our universe, everything from the smallest asteroid to the largest planets, stars, galaxies, and clusters rotates on their axes. Therefore, it is highly likely that the singularities of black holes in the universe also rotate on their axes. This is a logical question that was raised in the 1960s because neither Einstein's field equations nor Schwarzschild's equations provide an answer to this question. In 1963, Roy Kerr made several changes to Einstein's field equations and finally provided a solution for a rotating black hole. However, this solution was not simple, and in Roy Kerr's solution, the region around the black hole did not have just one event horizon. Instead, there were several regions you would encounter upon entering the black hole. The first of these regions is the ergosphere, where space-time moves very fast, but still not faster than the speed of light, so you can return to the universe from here. But if you pass through this, you reach the black hole's outer horizon, the point of no return. From there, you reach the black hole's inner horizon, where, surprisingly, you can move freely because, in Roy Kerr's black hole model, the inner horizon is where space-time almost breaks down, and there is no flow of time or space, nor any force pulling you towards the singularity. Here, you will see a round ring-like structure, which is the singularity of our rotating black hole. In Roy Kerr's rotating black hole, the singularity is not a point-like mass but a ring-like structure that has broken the space-time fabric, creating a hole in the space-time fabric. Most scientists believe that if you pass through this ring singularity, you will enter a white hole that will eject you into another universe. If Kerr's black hole is fitted into the Penrose diagram, the diagram does not close here but instead shows other universes on the other side of the black hole, where you can continually travel through black holes and white holes into different universes. In some of these universes, gravity would be attractive like in our universe, while in others, it would work oppositely. But to understand the truth of Roy Kerr's theory, we would need to jump into a giant black hole in our universe. Even then, the reality of the black hole will only be known to you. Once inside the black hole, you will only be able to receive information from outside, meaning you can only hear signals sent to you from Earth. However, no signal from you will be able to escape the black hole's event horizon, meaning we will never know what you saw inside or whether another world or universe exists beyond the black hole. What do you think? Could there be a multiverse beyond black holes? Or is it the end of time for us and our future? Let me know your answer in the comments below. If you like this video and learned something new, please like it and share it with your friends.